afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the Midday Refreshing with your host, Dr. Patty. And we are streaming live today and just very excited to be on a multiple platforms this afternoon, and just excited about the opportunity to bring to you this Midday Bible Study session. And I trust that you enjoyed the lesson last week as we are continuing with our series, Start Small, Finish Strong. Start Small, Finish Strong. Many of you may have started out the new year with great intentions of how you were going to bring about change in your life, and how you may have set goals for yourself and things that you wanted to achieve in 2017, and you may be at a point now, we're in the third month of the year, where you're finding where some of those big ambitious goals that you had have now fallen by the wayside. And so for the past several weeks, I have been doing a series, Start Small, Finish Strong, to help you to give you tips that will help you to be successful in achieving the goals that you have established for your life in this new year, whatever they may be, whether they're personal goals and things you're trying to do for yourself personally, whether they're things that you're trying to do and bring about change in your home, whether they're spiritual goals and visions that you have for yourself in terms of your Christianity and your spiritual walk with God, whether they're corporate goals that you may have or career goals that you may have corporately being in your church, where your church has set forth a theme for the year, and as a corporate body, you're moving towards that theme, whether it may be job goals, career goals, financial goals, whatever it is that you are trying to achieve in your life, we want to help you to be successful in moving in the right direction so that you can absolutely achieve the things that you have that you've put before yourself to do or put on the list. And so today we're going to continue with the series Start Small, Finish Strong. And our base scripture that we have been talking from has been Ecclesiastes, the 9th chapter, the 11th verse A. And it reads as thus, I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong. And we have stopped at that point specifically because there has been a cliche in the church that says that part, and then it says, but to the one who endures to the end. And obviously, that is not what this particular scripture says. That portion of it that we've added to make the cliche sentence has been taken from another scripture in the book of Matthew. And so here in the book of Ecclesiastes, Solomon is really talking about living life and what he has learned about life and the things that come upon you in life. And also he talks very poignantly about death, and that death is going to happen. It's inevitable that all of us must come to a point that we die. And so in that understanding, he makes the point that nothing that we do is whether you get there fast or whether you get there slow, you're going to eventually leave this earth. And so the race is not to the swift. It's not going to matter how strong or weak you are, but eventually there are a culmination of events that are going to occur in your life. And so we have taken that really to utilize that in helping you to best define the things in your life that are going to help you to be better, that are going to help you to improve the quality of your life, that are going to help you to walk in the abundance of your life, the abundance that God wants for you, with the understanding that in this walk, it is not a sprint. Our Christian walk is not a sprint. It's by all things, it is a marathon. It's going to take time. A marathon is a long race. And when you're in the race for a long time, you have to be trained. You have to be conditioned. If not, you're not going to make it. You're not going to survive. And so the same principles apply in our Christian walk. If you are not trained, if you are not equipped to handle the things that are going to come into your life and deal with them in your faith walk, you're not going to make it. You're not going to survive. You're going to fall by the wayside. And so when we set goals for ourselves, we have to understand that it comes a time when we have to understand there are going to be obstacles. There are going to be distractions. There are going to be hindrances in our life. There are going to be all kinds of things that may deter you from getting to what your goal is. Last week, we talked about renewing your mind, the transformation of your mind, and what it's going to take in order for you to be able to move in that direction of changing your thinking, changing your negative thinking, redefining how you perceive your goals instead of looking at them as something negative, look at them as something positive. We talked about going into the Lenten season. Lent started last week, March 1st, and we talked about your perception of what it is that you are going to change about yourself and give up during the Lenten season. Why? Because we're all trying to be better. We're all trying to be stronger, not only in the naturally, but spiritually. We're trying to strengthen the spiritual man. The only way that's going to happen is when you turn down and deny the things that your flesh likes, loves, and enjoys the most that may not necessarily be good for you. So, with that said, jumping into today's topic, we are talking about procrastination, moving past procrastination. And so I had the privilege a couple of weeks ago to interview Dr. Renate Ryman, who is the author of the book Beyond Procrastination. This is a great book, How to Stop Postponing Your Life. And if you go to my Facebook page at Dr. Patty Fitzhugh, you can get the excerpt of the interview that I had with her there. Very practical information in this book for those of you who may be stuck in certain areas of your life and you're wondering why you just can't seem to get going and doing the things that you're trying to do, trying to accomplish. You have mental blocks, you're dealing with fear, you're dealing with anxiety. This book provides very practical tips and information on how you can get beyond you and begin to move forward in seeing and being successful in the things you want to do. I love this book. Dr. Ryman is a great person, great individual. We had a great discussion. I was so blessed and fortunate to be able to get her to come on my show and actually have the interview with me. So you procrastinate. You procrastinate. You keep putting things off. You talk about how you want to do something, but you don't act on it. And so you are likened to a howling dog. And so the story refers to this dog who keeps howling because it's sitting on a nail. However, he refuses to get up from the nail. Why? Because it's not painful enough. And so you procrastinate on taking action because the situation is not painful enough for you yet. Listen, my father used to say to me when I was a kid, and I would say, I'm hungry. And he would say, if you're hungry, there's a bowl of beans over there. And I would say, I don't want beans. And he would say, well, then guess what? You're not really hungry, because if you were hungry, you would eat that bowl of beans out of there over there in the kitchen and satisfy your hunger. Many of you procrastinate because you're in a place where it hasn't gotten to a point where it's painful enough for you to get up and to do something about it. So you mull over it, you talk about it, you think about it, you say, I gotta do this, I gotta do that, but you don't do it. And then when it does become a time when it does get painful enough for you, that's often a time when it's too late to do anything about it. So you either need to start taking action or forever, as they say, hold your peace. It's your call. And so this is an excerpt from an article on lifehack.org, which I was talking about, 11 reasons why you aren't getting results. If you keep doing the same thing over and over again and thinking that you're going to produce outcomes that are different, the outcomes are going to be the same over and over and over again, and you will be stuck wandering in the wilderness. And so today I'm going to be talking from Exodus, the 16th chapter, and I'm going to start with verse 1, because the Israelites coming out of Egypt, coming out of bondage under the oppression, if you read Exodus, the first chapter, the oppression of hard taskmasters who had no mercy on them, who tried to kill them, who tried to wipe them out as a race. And so they cried out to God because they wanted to be liberated from the oppression of the Egyptians and from slavery. And so God gave them a leader in the person of Moses to bring them out of Egypt. And when God brought them out of Egypt, en route to the promised land, because they weren't just coming out of Egypt just to go in the wilderness and wander around for 40 days. God had a plan. God had a purpose. He was taking them somewhere. They were in the process. They were on a journey. How many of you know that God has a plan for you? God has a plan. You're in the process. You're in a journey. But you don't understand, if you don't understand the plan of God, if you don't understand the purpose of God for your life, then you will be like the Israelites, murmuring, complaining, fussing, and wanting to go back to that very thing that has put you in bondage and kept you entangled for years upon years upon years. Who wants that? And so when we talk about starting small and finishing strong, one of the biggest hindrances, and I've said this, in us being able to achieve and operate and move in the mode and plan of God for our life is us. It's not other people. It's us. Because when God says move, we don't move. We say, why? We say, I don't understand. That doesn't make sense to me. Why would God tell me to do that? It's not for us to understand. God said in his word, my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. And so we can't conceivably understand or apply logic to the things of a God that doesn't operate within the realms of logic. And so here we are now in a place where you're wondering why you can't get stuff done. You can't get off the sofa. See, I'm sitting on my sofa today for a reason. You can't get off your sofa. You can't get out your big chair to get things done because you sit there and reason with yourself. You got to listen to the interview with Dr. Vernot Ryman, because one of the things that we talked about was the battle that goes on within ourselves, how there's conflict within ourselves in discouraging us from getting things done. And so here it is, Exodus, the 16th chapter, and I'm going to start at verse 1, and I'm going to read from several different translations. I got my Jewish Study Bible, and I love this Bible so much, and so I'm going to read from this verse. It says, setting out from Elim, the whole Israelite community came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai. On the 15th day of the second month after their departure from the land of Egypt, in the wilderness, the whole Israelite community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. That's the first part. I want you to take note of that. Grumbling and complaining, okay? Grumbled against Moses and Aaron. Grumbling against the leader. Grumbling against the pastor. Why? The Israelites said to them, if only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots, when we ate our fill of bread. You have brought us out into this wilderness to starve this whole congregation to death. It would have been better if you would have just left us back in Egypt, and God, we could have died there, because at least there we had food to eat. We had a shelter. We may have hard taskmasters. They may have been oppressing us, but at least we had food and shelter. We had the basic essential things, Moses. You brought us out here in this wilderness. God, you sent me out here, took me out of my comfort zone. I don't understand this place. I want to go to the promised land. I want to hit the lottery. I want $1 million. I want a financial blessing. I want to get out of debt. I want to quit smoking. I want to better take care of my body, but that cake is so good. I want to exercise. I want to lower my blood pressure. But salt is so good to me. I want to make a change. Yes, I do. I don't want to be diabetic. No, I don't. But the things that got me to this place seem like they were good for me, even though they were bad. They are bad for me. And so when your doctor says you have to modify your diet and you have to change how you eat and you have to make change about the things that you do and you have to get up off the sofa and exercise, we don't want to do that. Why? Because that requires work. That requires effort. That requires energy. That requires time. That requires us to think. And so procrastination comes in because we feel it's too much. I can't put that much energy in it. It's tiring me out. It's wearing me down. This new eating habit, it costs too much money. I can't afford it. And so what happens? What happens to us? We're stuck. So we don't do anything. We don't do anything. And then now we're mad at God because we're stuck. We've made the choice not to do anything. It's not because God hasn't made the provision. God made a provision for you to come out. God made a way, hallelujah, for you to come out. But it's up to you. God gives us free will and choice. In everything we do, God gives us free will. We have the divine will of God and we have the permissive will of God. He gives us choice. And you get the right. Choose ye this day whom you will serve. David, Joshua asked the question. As for me and my house, this is what we're going to do. We're going to serve God. I don't like it. It's not always easy. There's a way that God takes. I used to say, I don't want to do the work of the Lord, because every time I get to doing the work of God, the devil attacks me, and I don't like the attacks. Trouble always comes in my life, and I don't like the trouble that comes in my life, so I'd rather just not do the work of God. That's what I said for 10 years. Now look at me. I'm sitting here teaching and equipping you to do the work of God, to move in your Christian walk, moving towards the things of God. Did you think that all these years that you've been serving the devil, that when you decided that you were going to serve God, that he's going to let you go so easily? The Egyptians didn't let the Israelites go so easily. Pharaoh got his armies together and said, holy moly, wait a minute. Who's going to be our servants? Who's going to be our maids? Who's going to build our kingdoms? Who's going to be our architects? Who's going to be our engineers? Who's going to do this labor? Who's going to do this work? Wait a minute now. We can't let them go. Get the chariots. Get the horses. Get the men. We got to go chase them people and get them back. Oh, no, the enemy is not going to let you go so easily. Did you think that those things, those habits that you made, that you have created for yourself, those strongholds, those entanglements, and those relationships that you had, did you think that when you made up in your mind, and you articulated and put in the atmosphere that this is what you were going to do, did you think that that thing was going to let you go so easily? Did you think that you were going to be able to walk away without a fight? Did you not think that the enemy was not going to have a strategy to get at you, to talk in your ear, to whisper to your mind? And we procrastinate. Why? Because we open up our ears to hear. It's a battle, y'all. It's a battle in trying to move in the direction. But thanks be unto God who is on our side. And that was it. If it had not been for the Lord on my side, where would I be? David said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken. God don't forsake his own. So this is what they say. If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt when we sat by the flesh pots, when we ate our fill of bread, ate till our bellies were full. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to starve this whole congregation to death. You brought us out there to die. We don't have no food to eat. In one of the other versions, and I'll get to that, it says, the Israelites said, why didn't God let us die in the comfort in Egypt where we had lamb stew and all the bread we could eat in the comfort? God, just let me die in my comfort zone. God saying, no, get up. Not God saying, get up. No, I'm not going to let you die in your comfort zone. Did you not think that I brought you this far that I would leave you or forsake you? You brought us out into this wilderness to starve us to death. No, we didn't. Everybody complained. So now Moses trying to follow the order of God. Your pastor trying to follow the order of God. And what are you doing? Giving them the blues. Complaining. Murmuring about it. Talking about it. See, murmuring is a bunch of whispering and a bunch of noise about something, but you never really come out and say it directly. You just murmur about it. So, this is what God said in the fourth verse. And the Lord said to Moses, I will rain down bread for you from the sky, and the people shall go out and gather each day that day's portion, that I thus test them to see whether they will follow my instructions or not. What you gonna do? Because God said, I hear you. I hear all the things that you're talking about. I'm ever present, all knowing, all seeing, omnipresent, omnipotent, all powerful, omniscient. I got all of that. I hear you. So this is what I'm gonna do. And trust me, I know God to be a provider. Those of you, some of you out there know what I'm talking about. And I'm not talking about a cliche. I'm not talking about saying it because I heard somebody else saying it. Listen. When change comes about your life and God brings you out of oppression and God takes you to a place that's called the wilderness. First of all, you got to be in the wilderness because you need detox. They were in the wilderness roaming around 40 because they needed detox. You don't want to deal with the detox. Part of Lent is detoxing because we create habits for ourselves on a day-to-day basis. So when we're talking about goals that are measurable and achievable, it's because you need to detox. Detox from the television. Detox from the bad eating habits. Detox because you haven't been exercising. You need to detox and put down the things that are appealing to your fleshly man and begin to now feed the spiritual man. That's the person who needs to be fed, because ultimately when the spiritual man is strong, when the issues of life come upon you, you will be able to handle it. That's why they used to talk about storing up prayer. That's why they used to talk about fasting. We don't talk about it so much more because people can't hardly turn down their plate for 2 hours. That's why we talk about these things in the church, to detox us from our very sinful nature. Now, your sinful nature is always going to be there. It's ever present until you die. But there are some things that you can do to bring about change in your life. And so God said to Moses, I'm going to rain down bread from the skies for you. The people will go out and gather each day ration. That's from the Message Bible. And he said, and I'm going to test them to see if they're going to live according to my teaching or not. Are you going to live according to the word, or are you going to sit there and not? God has already said, okay, this is your request. Okay, I got that. See, there's nothing too hard for God. There's nothing too big for God. There's nothing too little for God. But do you want to wait for the timing of God? See, that's it right there. The timing of God. Or do you want to complain about it? I can't. The Bible says faith without works are dead. It's dead. Ain't that what it says? Faith, go to the book of James. Faith without works is dead. You got to write the vision, set your goals. I said 2, no more than 2. Okay? If you're in Lent season, you're giving up something. Okay? Then you need to evaluate and understand what it is that's troubling you and why. what is the biggest reason why you're not getting it? When you start going through that exchange between your head with yourself, you need to make note of what's the conversation that you're having with yourself as to why you're not able to get this thing done. Why can't you get any momentum? Why can't you get any movement? Okay? Because God says everything you need is right here. I've given you the roadmap for your success. I've given you the GPS. You put in the coordinates. I've given you the roadmap of how to get there. I've given you step-by-step instructions on what to do. And you still won't do it. So, are we blaming God for why stuff ain't happening fast enough? Or is it really you? Because you're procrastinating. And that's what we need to get to. We need to get you beyond procrastination. Starting small, moving towards your goal. Moving towards the place that God wants you to be at. It's not going to come overnight. It's a process. They did not get to the promised land in one day when they left Egypt. They didn't go straight to the promised land because it was a process. God is taking you through a process. Some of you got to die before you can live again. Some of you have to die to yourself before you can live again. There's some stuff in you God wants to kill and get out of you before you can even get there. Before you can even step into that. See, we want the provision and the promise, but we don't want to go to the work. There's a process of getting from when God makes the promise and the provision, there's still a time period in between that, all this in between, of getting you there. In the meantime, we're in the meantime. That's from the provision of what God said he was going to do, the promise of what God said he was going to do to actually getting to that thing. And there's some work that has to be done in the middle. Galatians, Paul said, ye did run well. And I got to close with this. You did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? What happened? What is hindering you? Because you started off with the new year. You hit the ground running. And you were off to a good start. And now, we in the third month of the year, and now you discouraged. You unmotivated. You're uninspired. You're tired. You don't want to do that anymore because it takes too much work. I want to do the next new shiny thing that I think I can do. And so, what I'm saying to you is that we're going to narrow it down to one or two things. And you're going to have, and what you should consider is SMART goals. Specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, and put a time on it. You did run well. What is it that's hindering you? What is it that's keeping you from walking in the fullness of God's word? Because God already told you what he's going to do. See, some of you keep saying, I'm waiting on God. But God said, I'm waiting on you. I remember one morning I was laying in my bed, and I'm closing with this. And I was going through the very roughest time of my life. And I was in Baltimore, and Sunday Morning Joy, I think that was the name of it, came on the radio. And Pastor, now Bishop Frank Reed, was the host of the show. And I remember I used to always listen to Tamla Man, Take Me to the King, because I was just broken, and I was in broken pieces, and my heart was broken, and I was just laying there, just dying, and just, you know, going through it. And I remember waking up that morning, and I had been going back and forth about some things, and I didn't know what to do. And I said, well, I'm just going to sit here and wait on God. Because I was like, in the waiting on God, am I supposed to still do certain things in the waiting, or am I supposed to do nothing? And so my mentor said, while you are waiting on God, you need to be putting some things into the pipeline, into the works. And while you're doing that, you still believing and trusting that God is going to bless it, that he's going to come through for you. And he will. Eventually he will. But in the meantime, you can't just sit there and say, I'm just going to wait. I need a new car, but I'm going to sit here and just wait for one to show up at my front door. No, you got to get online. You got to shop. You got to look at dealerships, Craigslist, wherever it is that you may be. You have to do something. Doing nothing is not the solution. And so your waiting doesn't mean doing nothing. So God said he's waiting on you. And so Pastor Reed said, some of you are laying there and you're saying to yourself, you waiting on God. Well, God said he's waiting on you. And I knew that it was the Lord speaking because I had laid there and I had tossed and turned and toiled about it. And I said, well, I'm just going to wait because I don't know what to do. And then that immediate moment when he said, you said, you're waiting on God. God said he's waiting on you. I knew that that was the answer. God was waiting for me to get up. Get up. Get up. Get up from that place. Get up from that sofa. Get up from your chair. Get up. Make that phone call. Get online. Look up that school that you've been thinking about going to. Get that paperwork going that's been sitting on your desk. Get up. Change those eating habits. Make a conscious decision. Systematically, I'm going to change. Walk around for 15 minutes of the day if that's all you can do to exercise. But get up. Get moving. He already told you to move forward when he brought you out of Egypt. And you keep making excuses because it's comfortable. There's nothing that we ever going to do for God that's ever going to be comfortable. Because you know why he wants to get you out of your comfort zone? Because he wants you to lean and depend on him solely. We talk about, Jehovah Jireh, he's my provider. Jehovah Shammah, he's my strength. Jehovah Tiskanu, Jehovah Nisi, yes, hallelujah. Mm-hmm. And then when you go home after the music stops playing and the lights go out, is he really your provider? Is he really your strength? Is he really your rock? Is he really your everything? Or does it sound good? See, this is where we take what we are learning in God's word and in our churches, and now it's time for practical application. That's why God has to test you. That's why he said here that I'm going to do these things for them, I'm going to give them food. Every day, go out and get your ration. And then I'm going to test you to see, are you going to live according to his word or not? And that's where we're at. Are you going to live according to his word or not? He's brought you out. Don't go back. Don't go back. Don't be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Paul said, who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? Once you've been set free, there's still a process from getting set free to now moving into that place where you're fully healed, where you're fully delivered, where it don't bother you no more. You got to go through that. You have to go through detox in order to get there. And so I'm done. I've got to stop for today. But I encourage you to stay connected to us, to follow us on Facebook, on It's a New Day or New Day Ministries. Make sure you're New Day Ministries of North Carolina and Baltimore. You can also follow Dr. Patty Fitzhugh on Facebook. I encourage you to go to our website at Dr. Patty, www.drpattycares.com. There's always information there about me, about what's going on, about what's next, the things that we're doing, working in the community. Subscribe to be on our mailing list and follow us. We have great plans in store for you. We have great plans in store for the things of the ministry, and we're very, very excited to be a part of Life Vision TV in this new launch this year with New Day Ministries and bringing you this broadcast on a weekly basis. I trust that it's been a blessing to you. If you'd like to write me or email me, you can email me at info@drpattycares.com. Be blessed, everybody. Have a blessed blessed week, and we will see you next time.